Good morning to all of you. The today's topic is the hydric adaptations. The plants growing under the hydric conditions are generally called as the hydrophytes. Adaptations present in these plants are called as the hydric adaptations. The environment shows the following characters: the amount of the water which is extra than the requirements of the plants. The plants are live totally, partially, grows in wet places having a more water in the soil, the habitat in the form of the reservoir, both fresh and salt water, the environment with a great uniformity, oxygen supply, which is the relatively less, no evaporation, no transpiration. Morphological adaptations in hydrophytes. While you observe the different plants, those are growing in the water, in some plants, the roots, these are the poorly developed one. The best example is the hydrilla. In some plants, the such roots, these are completely absent. The best example, that is the salvinia. But when we observe all such plants, the root hairs, these are absent or poorly developed one. Root caps are absent, but the root pockets are present, particularly in Echornea. Now you switch over to the stem. In such hydrophytes, while you observe the stem, most of the hydrophytes, they shows the herbaceous stem, delicate one, long, slender, spongy, as well as the well-developed, particularly in hydrilla. But in some plants, which is a modified into a rhizome, the best example is the nymphia and typha. The leaves in a reddish area, thin, long, ribbon-like, particularly in a nymphia, the leaves, these are the flat, entire, covered by a waxy coating. While you observe the Echornea, in Echornea, the leaves, you observe the peculiar type of petiole. The petioles, these are the long, swollen, spongy one. Anatomical adaptations of hydrophytes. While you observe the root part, when you take the TS of root, in the TS, the cuticle, spines and hairs, these are the absent one. But in amphibious hydrophytes, shows the presence of root hairs. While you observe the epidermis, in all such hydrophytes, the epidermis, which is the single layer thin wall with a presence of chloroplast. After completion of that epidermal region, below that epidermis, there is a presence of cortex, and that cortex, which is the broad, well-developed one, parenchymatous, that means the parenchymatous in nature, with there is a presence of air spaces and air chambers, help for the gaseous exchange and in a floating. In such a plants, while you observe the vascular tissues, that vascular tissues, these are poorly developed and less differentiated into a xylem, but shows the tracheids in a submerged forms. Phloem is well developed, differentiated in amphibious. In all these plants, the pith, which is the absent one. Then we observe the stem. In a stem anatomy, it shows the following anatomical adaptations. While you observe the TS, in a TS, the outer layer, that is the cuticle, and such a cuticle, which is the absent one, but in some plants, which is the poorly developed one. Below cuticle, there is a presence of epidermis. That epidermis, which is the parenchymatous, single layer. While you observe the rhizome of typha, shows a well-developed epidermis. Then below epidermis, there is a presence of hypodermis. That hypodermis, which is the thin-walled one, parenchymatous or collenchymatous, found particularly in floating and emerged forms. Below hypodermal region, there is a presence of cortex, and such a cortex, which is the well-developed, thin-walled, parenchymatous, possess the chloroplast. The air chambers are well-developed, helps for the gaseous exchange. Below cortical region, there is a presence of endodermis, and it is a clearly distinct one in such hydrophytes. In a stem part, below that epidermis, there is a presence of vascular system, and while you concentrate on that vascular system, it is not a well-developed one, except amphibious, the vascular elements like xylem and phloem are present, but the xylem and phloem, these are thin-walled. While you observe the mechanical tissues, these are poorly developed or absent. Then leaves, In a leaves of such hydrophytes, some anatomical adaptations are seen. When we take the TS of leaf of Nymphia, in that Nymphia, there is a presence of cuticle, that is the outer layer, that outer layer which is the absent one. But in some plants which is the poorly developed, particularly in Nymphia, below cuticle there is a presence of epidermis, and that epidermis is single layer one, parenchymatous with plentiful chloroplast. While you observe the stomatas are absent in a submerged, but in a floating forms they are present only on upper epidermis. The mesophyll region, particularly in submerged forms, not clearly differentiated, but in other forms, which is clearly differentiated into a spongy parenchyma and palisade layer. The vascular system in such a leaf, in a submerged forms, which is a poorly developed one, but in Nymphia shows thin-walled xylem and well-developed phloem. When you observe the floating forms, there is a presence of mucilaginous glands. Then the mechanical tissue in such a leaf of hydrophytes, such a mechanical tissue which is absent or weakly developed. After completion of anatomical adaptations, these hydrophytes in which some physiological adaptations are seen, the osmotic pressure of the cell sap is nearly equal or slightly higher than the surrounding water medium. Whole plant soak up the nutrients and water concentrations. The oxygen evolved during the photosynthesis is partially used for the respiration. The chloroplasts are scattered all over the plant body. Carbon dioxide evolved during the respiration is to somewhat extent utilized for the photosynthesis, which is stored in air cavities.